love reading the different renditions of the Lord's table as they're taught in the Gospels, the different Gospels. Here I'm reading from Luke 22, verse 7. It says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed." So this was the Jewish Passover. This was what the Lord had given to Israel to celebrate their deliverance from the land of Egypt. Spiritually, as pertains to what we're doing here, it's a picture of our deliverance through our Passover lamb, who is Christ. But what strikes me here is the simplicity with which we are celebrating, not with fanfare, not with pomp and circumstance, but with two elements. Just like what was vital in that old Jewish Passover, even though there were herbs and there was the lamb to be slain that was part of the feast, yet the only two elements that remain today are what? It's the unleavened bread, because that's what was celebrated. No bread with leaven was to be eaten, and the cup, which represents the blood shed of the lamb. That's it. Why just those two? Well, because the bitter herbs are done. There's no more suffering that is necessary for Christ. He doesn't have to come back and suffer again and again for this fulfillment. It was one time. And there's no lamb to be slain because Christ the Lamb was slain. But what's left are these two elements. And so, as the Lord, verse 8, sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare us the Passover that we may eat." And they said unto him, "Where wilt thou that we prepare?" And he said unto them, "Behold, when you are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you bearing a pitcher of water." Typically, it was the women that carried the water. Unusual circumstance here with a man. "Follow him into the house where he entereth in, and ye shall say unto the good man of the house." I don't believe the Lord used that word just in general, but here was one of the Lord's, a good man, in the sense by God's grace and goodness, one for whom he would soon be paying his sin debt, but having this house. "And tell him, the master saith unto thee, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished." I love that. That what this represents in the person and work of Christ, a large upper room furnished, there make ready. "And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And when the hour was come," I love those parts of Scripture, "when the hour was come," everything unfolding exactly as God purposed. Even Christ in the flesh, he did not cease being God. He was directing all things to this end that the Father had given him to accomplish. "When the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him, and he said unto them, with desire have I desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." Think, from all eternity, God purposed that this hour should come where he himself would be the fulfillment of what every one of those Passovers represented. You talk about something historic that we're celebrating here. It's not just a tradition. It's been nearly 2,000 years that this table that we're partaking of was instituted by our Lord Jesus Christ in memory of him. But Christ said, of all of those Passovers, this is the one I've desired to eat with you before I suffer. "For I say unto you, I will not eat any more thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Now, if you're thinking kingdom of God is still in the future, then that means it's not been fulfilled. But that's not what he's saying. What he's saying here, speaking of this being fulfilled in the kingdom of God, he's speaking of his death. When he should lay down his life, that lamb shedding his blood, God's lamb. John the Baptist preached that. "Behold the lamb Someone asks, well, where's the lamb? I see the bread and I see the cup. Where's the lamb? The lamb was slain once, forever. What we have here is this cup that remembers that blood shed. How important are these two elements? Well, it's been fulfilled. I'm not talking about some kingdom in the future. It's talking about him having fulfilled it. And he said, I'll not eat any more thereof until it be fulfilled. Now it's fulfilled. You say, well, where is he eating this now? Well, he's present. Even as we partake, he's present in the hearts of his people. Partaking with those that he has redeemed. So he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. There again, when did the kingdom of God come? Well, it came in his person, but it was fully established, the foundation laid, when he laid down his life, and died and rose again, and said, on high. He took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. When he said, this is my body, he's not saying that it becomes his body by some sort of magic. There's some that actually believe that through incantations and things that this turns into the body of Christ. But he's talking about it as a picture. This do in remembrance of me. It'd be like if I took a picture of myself and said, see me? I'm holding the picture. And you're saying, no, that's not you. I see you. Well, it's a representation. That's what this is. This do in remembrance of me. You can't remember someone you've never known. So if someone asks, well, should I partake of the Lord's table? Who is the Lord to you? Has he been revealed in your heart? Do you know him by the Spirit of God to be the Lord and Savior, the one who shed his blood to save wretched sinners such as we are? This do in remembrance of me. That's what we're remembering. We're not remembering our goodness. We're remembering his. That's why it's unleavened bread. There's no sin in him. Sin was laid on him, but no sin in him. Now, it may surprise you in verse 20 when it speaks again of the cup, but the first cup he took was the Passover cup. That was the last time he took it. That's why he said, I'll not eat or drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come, until this is fulfilled. He fulfilled it. But now, this cup, verse 20, is the cup that we have that he gave us in remembrance, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Again, remember, a testament is a will and testament. It's for those who are named in that will. But it's in his blood, and he says, which is shed for you. That word shed means with specific purpose. There was an execution that took place there on the cross. Had Christ not come to pay the sin debt, there was nothing in him that would ever have caused him to ever die. He would have continued to live forever in that perfect body, which is represented by the unleavened bread. But the reason he died is because there was an execution. God the Father put upon him the sin of his people. Therefore, it required him that he should die. Justice be satisfied. So that's what we're remembering. He took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them. And then he took the cup the same way, giving thanks and gave it to them. This do in remembrance of me. Gracious Father, as we partake, I pray that your Spirit would turn our eyes to your blessed Son. Not on ourselves, there's nothing good in us. Not on each other, there's no one here to whom we dare even compare ourselves. But our eyes on your blessed Son, the one that you sent in the fullness of the time and made a woman, made under the law, that he might redeem such as we are that were under that law's condemnation. But being redeemed, there is therefore now no condemnation. So that's what we celebrate. And we do this until you come again, remembering the person of your Son, his glorious, holy, righteous, and his work. Shed blood. It was required that you might be a just God and Savior. Oh, may our hearts ever rejoice in him and him alone. In his name I pray. Amen.